I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines: Wall Street drops on inflation concerns and a sharp sell-off in tech shares. Asian markets set to follow suit. Here at home, the PSEI snaps its six-day losing streak, climbing back to 6,300. How are investors positioning their bets as the Philippines releases its first quarter growth figures this morning at 10? We are carrying that live. Meanwhile, Aaron Tsai of First Metro Securities joins us later for a market outlook. U.S. regulators authorize the use of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine for children as young as 12 years old. And President Rodrigo Duterte admits asking for China's help in securing COVID-19 vaccines, but says there will be no compromise with Beijing in the West Philippine Sea issue. We begin with the financial markets. Wall Street declining on Monday as inflation fears drove investors away from market-leading growth stocks in favor of cyclicals, which stand to benefit most as the U.S. economy reopens. The Nasdaq plunging 2.5%, with big tech as the biggest drag. Investors exited big tech like Microsoft and Apple. Facebook dropping 4%, while Amazon and Netflix both fell more than 3% each. Tesla also shedding over 6%. Meanwhile, industrial and healthcare shares limited the Dow's decline, but still ended Monday's session lower, snapping a three-day streak of record closing highs. The S&P 500 also fell 1%. Utilities and consumer staples were the biggest gainers on Monday. Meanwhile, inflation concerns will be in the minds of investors when the U.S. Labor Department releases its latest CPI report this Wednesday. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, seems like the decline will continue for the Nasdaq and the S&P 500 when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Turning now to the Colonial Pipeline cyber attack, the U.S. is now investigating the ransomware group DarkSide if it has ties to Russia. DarkSide is being blamed for the hack, and a top White House national security official says the FBI has been tracking the group since at least October 2020. As to whether the U.S. government was advising Colonial on whether to pay a ransom, the White House says no advice has been given at this time. As for U.S. President Joe Biden, he says so far there was no evidence that Russia was involved in the hack.
I'm going to be meeting with President Putin, and so far there is no evidence based on from our intelligence people that Russia is involved, although there is evidence that the actor's ransomware is in Russia. They have some responsibility to deal with this. The Department of Energy is working directly with Colonial to get the pipelines back online and operating at full capacity as quickly and safely as possible. The FBI also is engaged to assess the and address this attack. The agencies across the government have acted quickly to mitigate any impact on our fuel supply.
The cyber attack on Colonial Pipeline, which provides nearly half the fuel to the U.S. East Coast, is one of the most disruptive digital ransom schemes ever reported. It has triggered worries of retail gasoline spikes and laid bare the vulnerabilities of U.S. energy infrastructure to hackers. Colonial Pipeline is now on its fourth day of shutdown and is unlikely to resume full operations for several more days. Now, over here in Asia, stocks decline in early trade following that tech sell-off on Wall Street. Japan's Nikkei 225 suffering the biggest plunge as it drops 1.7%. Shares in South Korea and Australia also in the red. Now, China's inflation data will be on investors' watch list today. The expectation: consumer price index up 1% last month from a year ago, accelerating from 0.4% in March. Investors here in Asia also turning their focus to other economic data releases happening in the region. First up, the Philippines will announce its first quarter GDP figures. That's out at 10 this morning. ANC will carry that live. Now, remember, last year, the Philippine economy contracted 9.6%, its worst contraction on record because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Economists believe the slump will likely continue in the first quarter of this year. Now, if this happens, it would be the fifth straight quarter of contraction for the Philippine economy. Malaysia also releasing its growth figures for the first 3 months of the year. Malaysia's economy shrank 5.6% last year. Now, economists see a less severe contraction in the first quarter, helped by resilient manufacturing activity and growing external demand. And as we mentioned earlier, China will be announcing its April inflation numbers. The consumer price index in China rose by 0.4% in March, the highest reading since October last year, amid a sharp rebound in cost of non-food goods. For our first guest this morning, we have Megaworld's Kevin Tan, Chief Strategy Officer. He actually saw a boom in Iloilo long before others did. And now Megaworld is reaping the benefits. Kevin, finally, we have you on the show. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Michelle, for having me.
Okay, so Kevin, your research, what does it tell you about the direction of the property market? I know that leasing, for example, is now 30% of your business. What does it tell you about rents? What does it tell you about sales for your property developments?
Well, I think our outlook is generally optimistic, and the property sector has remained pretty resilient even through the pandemic now. When you look at, for example, Metro Manila, despite the softening in demand, and that I think is very temporary, we do see prices remain stable, no? Especially, for example, for condominiums and in the segment where Megaworld operates, we've seen the prices actually hold their ground, which is a good thing considering all things being considered. For land prices, exclusive subdivisions, ours included, we've also seen, in fact, prices go up. Now, one of the things that excites us right now, though, is really the growth that we are seeing outside Metro Manila, especially in places where Megaworld operates in, and that's why we're able to see these things firsthand. Places like Pampanga, Cavite, Bacolod, and Iloilo. We're seeing, you know, robust take-ups there for our horizontal and vertical developments. You know, we've had several project launches last year at the height of the pandemic in those areas, and some of them are either 100% sold out or at the very least around 60-70% sold out today. So,
wow.
And the demand continues to grow there, and prices also continue to appreciate in those areas. Mm-hmm. For the office segment, last year we did a total of 270,000 square meters of lease transactions. Half of that were new transactions, including expansions, and half of that were renewals. This year, we're looking to surpass that. We're looking to do at least 300,000 square meters of lease transactions. So our general sentiment is very much very optimistic, and mm-hmm. we're actually quite excited about all the new investments that's happening actually outside Metro Manila.
Kevin, I want to talk about Iloilo. Now the brightest spot in your office leasing portfolio, you're mm-hmm. seeing that boom. Did it come as a surprise? I know that Megaworld started investing there as early as 2013. What did you see?
Well, you know, what impressed us about Iloilo was, in fact, the way the city was developed, you know, the infrastructure that was put into that city. You know, they have very good, nice airports, very, very nice roads, sufficient and stable power supply. I mean, those are the things that really attract a lot of our investors. Another thing that was that strike us was the number of graduates that was produced by the local universities in Iloilo. Iloilo produces anywhere from 25 to 30,000 graduates every year. And that is a source for talent for the growing BPO sector. That's why we are, you know, we are doing very well in Iloilo. We have currently 100,000 square meters of office space there, comprising of 70% of the total office market there. All of that is 100% leased out. And currently we're building another 40,000 square meters, which we will be delivering in phases starting next year.
So I guess, Kevin, as Chief Strategy Officer, where is the next boom likely going to be? What's the next Iloilo that you see, perhaps in Visayas or in Mindanao?
Well, right now, as I mentioned, we discussed four mm-hmm. areas. We're seeing a lot of demand coming from Pampanga. We're also seeing a lot of demand coming from Cavite as well and Bacolod. So these are basically the four areas where we will be really focusing our attention on maybe this year and next year. So we're very, very bullish actually with these areas.
And have you factored in the macroeconomic outlook? For example, we're getting first quarter GDP numbers in less than an hour. How are people in the C-suite viewing where the economy is right now and the kind of recovery you expect?
I think a lot will really depend overall on how quickly we can vaccinate our population, most especially Metro Manila. I think it's really critical that we achieve a herd immunity here in Metro Manila, because Metro Manila or the NCR region still is the center of our economy. Mm-hmm. So a lot is dependent on that. I think that when the vaccination does kick in, the consumer confidence can be restored. You'll see probably a lot of pent up demand, or what they call revenge spending. So I think there's going to be a lot of growth in retail, shopping, restaurants, entertainment. I think also there's going to be a lot of domestic travel happening. Mm-hmm. Last quarter, we did see some of our outside Metro Manila locations, our tourist destinations, actually experiencing good occupancy. And so we've got a taste of that, and we think that that can very much happen again in a very sustained manner as well. I don't think international travel will kick in anytime soon. I think that's going to take a while. But I think we have a very robust domestic tourism industry.
Kevin, given all of these assumptions, then when are you expecting to see a turnaround in profit growth? Most property players continue to see drop in earnings up until first quarter. That's not news. That's expected. That's for everybody. But when do you expect a turnaround to profit growth? Realistically, is it this year? Is it happening by the fourth quarter? Or are you waiting for next year?
I think this year we can, overall, I think starting the second half, we can expect some growth. I think single digits for overall for Mega World. I think our focus right now is we want to be resilient and we want to be profitable, no? And to achieve certain growth this year and next year. I don't think we will be anywhere near our 2019 numbers. That was a banner year for everyone. I think it will take a while for us to be able to get back to that level. But at the very least, I think this year we can expect maybe single-digit growth.
And I know, Kevin, that you've set aside a more targeted CapEx this year. It's bigger compared to last year, but it's very targeted. It's 36 billion pesos. 76% will go to development projects, 24% for investment properties, and zero allocation for land banking. Why zero? I mean, is no one selling at this point? Are there no good prices?
We approach our CapEx, of course, with a little bit of caution still, no? Of course, we do have priorities right now, which is to complete a lot of our development projects and our recurring income projects as well. We're also quite comfortable with our current land bank. We have about 4,500 hectares of undeveloped land right now. So we're quite comfortable with that. But I think it's not to say that we're not going, we can't change strategy midway through. We remain open to opportunities if they come our way, and we can actually revise the CapEx and the allocations further on this year.
And for those, Kevin, who are not too familiar, what exactly do you mean by investment properties?
I mean, when I say investment property, I meant our recurring income properties.
Recurring
malls, yeah.
Okay. And finally, REITs, how soon? I know the REITs has been postponed from the second half of last year. Is it finally happening this year, Kevin?
Yes, we're looking to launch our REIT by second half. I can't say much. You'll have to wait for the announcement, but I can tell you it's going to be big.
Wow. Okay. On that note, Kevin, thank you so much for joining us, and good luck in your projects.
Thank you, Michelle.
Have a good day.
Have a good day.
Hello, local research group says Metro Manila and its surrounding areas are ready for looser quarantine restrictions as COVID-19 cases trend downward. According to Dr. Guido David from the Octa Research Group, the National Capital Region is now averaging less than 2,000 cases per day. The reproduction rate or the transmission rate has also declined. But David notes that the easing of restrictions should be calibrated and gradual.
We can increase capacity slowly, you know, for example, in some establishments from 10% to 20% or 10% to 30%. What we don't want to do is open up everything, you know, instantly. If we open up everything, the possible message is that everything's okay. And, you know, people might start to become complacent again. I mean, we have to remind people that the variants are still spreading.
The Philippines logged 6,846 COVID-19 cases last Friday, bringing the overall total to 1.1 million. Now, active infections are now around 59,000, while the death toll stands at over 18,500. Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte reveals he personally asked China for help in fighting COVID-19. Duterte says he called Chinese President Xi Jinping and asked if Beijing could spare jabs against the deadly virus. But Duterte insists the issue about the West Philippine Sea was never discussed during that conversation. Duterte then said he owes a debt of gratitude to China for donating millions of COVID-19 vaccines to the Philippines.
It is never, never wrong to say that I owe you a debt of gratitude. Totoo eh. Binigyan tayo, tinanggap natin, ginamit natin. But it does not mean na tanggapin ko yung bakuna at tapos sabihin ko, kalimutan ko na yung claim dyan sa West Philippine Sea. Okay na yun dahil sa bako. It is never like that. There will be no compromise. Alam ng China, baske antay dito ng vaccine, gagamitin ko pa rin. So sabihin ko, hindi ito yung kabayaran. Iba ito. This is Philippine national interest.
The U.S. Food and Drug Administration has authorized the use of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine for children as young as 12 years old. The move is seen as an important step for getting children back into schools safely. An advisory committee of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention will meet in the coming days to review the data and make recommendations for the vaccine's use in 12 to 15-year-olds. Nearly 46% of people in the U.S. have received at least one shot of a COVID-19 vaccine, but the pace of vaccinations there has slowed significantly.
We know this is a big step for our country. Vaccinating a younger population brings us closer to returning to a sense of normalcy and to ending the pandemic. Now, parents and guardians can rest assured that in making our decision, the agency undertook a rigorous and thorough review of all available scientific data, as we have with all the COVID-19 vaccine authorizations.
The U.S. Food and Drug Administration has authorized the use of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine for kids. That was the story that we had the last time. Okay, I think we're ready to go to a break now. Coming up, how will investors position their bets as the Philippines releases its first quarter growth figures? Aaron Tsai of First Metro Securities will join us for some perspective when Market Edge returns.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find they're so much into giving to the less fortunate folks.
The Philippines' first quarter growth figures at 10 this morning. Aaron Tsai of First Metro Securities joins us for a market outlook. We'll also be speaking with Stevie Kunyeng of Evercore Asia for a preview chat ahead of that report that's happening at 9:40 this morning. And U.S. regulators authorizing the use of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine for children as young as 12 years old. And President Rodrigo Duterte admits he asked for help from China in securing COVID-19 vaccines, but he says there will be no compromise with Beijing on the West Philippine Sea issue. The Philippine Stock Exchange will begin trading in about 8 minutes. We're kicking off from 63.17. We did snap a six-day losing streak yesterday. Joining us now for his take on the markets, Aaron Tsai of First Metro Security. Hi, Aaron. Good morning.
Hi, good morning, Mimi.
Okay, so I guess let's start with the outlook. Have we priced in too much of the bad news already? I mean, is first quarter GDP news going to be a non-event? I mean, after all, it's an after fact, a number that really just merely looks back.
Well, I think at 6.3, no? At 6.3, on the contrary, I think the market is still pricing in too much optimism, I believe, no? On what the immediate future would bring for the earnings of the PSEI constituents. No? So I think this can be implied by from the 33% increase expected, no, from the earnings of PSEI constituents in the next 12 months, no, compared to what they earned in the past 12 months. So although this is a possibility, definitely, no, given the low base that we're coming off of, and we can see that the vaccination program of the government is actually getting some traction, no, based on my observation, I think caution is still warranted, no, considering that new daily cases are still elevated. Yes, lower, no, lower than the peak, but still elevated compared to what we saw in the early fourth quarter of last year. So, and transmission of the virus is still happening. So I think it would take time. Now, definitely, it would take time before people can convince themselves to really go out as comfortable as they were pre-pandemic and resume their activities and their spending habits pre-COVID. And we know, now we know, as we go through the GDP, no, we know that it would take that kind of psychology before we can anticipate earnings of corporates to go back to pre-COVID levels. No? So, pero having said that, however, no, looking at the chart of the PSEI, the direction is still a clear downtrend. No? The direction is still clear downtrend, but it looks like a bullish wedge pattern is forming. No, it has not broken out of that pattern yet, but if it breaks out, then we might see some bounce, at least, no, from the PSEI. But again, until it happens, no, the trend is our friend and the trend is still downtrend.
Wow, the trend is our friend, but it's still downtrend. Okay, just very quickly, Aaron, first quarter GDP, what is this market pricing in? You're saying it's pricing in too much optimism still.
Yes, well, I definitely hope for a positive number, no, but I'm not too optimistic about it, no. Actually, for me, the first quarter GDP can actually be a possible example of counting the eggs before they hatch. No, some people who have expected too much from the rebound of economic activity have anticipated positive growth in the first quarter. And the surge we have seen in recent months, plus the ECQ imposed in response to that surge, caused them to take a caution stance again. Even if they have seen already the vaccines coming in already, you know. So again, I think this process takes time, although there's a good probability that 2Q 2021 year-on-year GDP growth would come out to be positive, no? Mainly due to the low base effect, no? It is a good thing that the headline job numbers are improving, no? We have seen that recently, although there were some concerns on the source of improvements in the jobs figure. It is always a good thing that people still have source of income, which they can spend, no, to get the economy going, which would eventually be reflected on the GDP.
Okay. Aaron, let's go over some interesting corporate stories from this morning. Manila Water, you know, we're already at the tail end of the earnings season. Manila Water, for the first quarter of this year, reporting net income at 1.3 billion pesos, down 8%. This revenue fell 12%. They're actually citing lower billed volumes from their commercial and industrial segments in the East Zone concession. And from the non-East Zone, these are areas where they have work in Davao, Clark, Laguna, Leyte, even international businesses actually helped offset that weakness. What is your take on Manila Water at this point?
Well, again, the 12% decline in revenue, no, was mainly due to the lower bid volume across the business segments. Actually, mm-hmm. no, there are just a few not very significant contributor, no, in the revenue mix of the company that has come out to be positive, no. But the decline, no, was actually across the board, but mainly from the lower demand from the commercial and the industrial clients in mm-hmm. the Eastern concession, no. I think we can continue to expect this to be the case until we see commercial and industrial clients restore their normal consumption, no, moving forward. But one silver lining from this, no, is that even though we saw that the company that the company has lower revenues, no, actually EBITDA from the operations of the East Zone actually dropped, no, due to the lower revenue, but EBITDA margin was the company was able to keep EBITDA margin to at 71%, which again implies that cost management is possible, no, in the face of lower revenues. Cost management is possible and was actually instituted, which helped to mitigate the effect of lower revenue to the bottom line of the company.
Okay, very interesting take there. How about this one? The Banco Central yesterday announcing that foreign direct investment net inflows went up by 21% to $1.6 billion in the first 2 months of this year. That's January and February. So the foreign money, they're coming here for the hard assets or investments. But the hot money, unfortunately, they're not here. The foreigners continue to sell off the local bourse. Are you expecting to see a turnaround soon?
Definitely not soon. No, again, we know that the hot money is after the short-term opportunities. No, we know the characteristics of hot money to go where the money is now. No, and definitely that is not in our markets. No, our market has been going lower, and other markets are actually soaring. No, so definitely, I think at least in the short term, we might not be. It would not be well. Maybe appropriate now to anticipate the coming back of portfolio investment, but I think moving forward, now again, I think the fundamentals are still good. No? That's the rhetoric, that fundamentals are still good, but again, sentiment is not there yet, and again, hot money is hot for a purpose.
Okay, Aaron, you have all of these quotable quotes this morning, huh? Okay, here's an interesting foreign news. Not just foreign, I'm pretty sure it affects a lot of our local players. Iron ore, extremely hot. Hot, and very hot. Yesterday at the open, they surged, 10%? And they're adding to a commodities boom. Is this, you think, plus the recent lifting of the moratorium on new mining contracts here in the Philippines, are those two enough to get you or your investors to buy into mining counters today?
Well, the short answer is yes. The uptrend in the commodity space actually started in 2017 for nickel, and around 2016 for iron ore. No, copper actually is a latecomer. No, copper, which started its run just in 2020. No? I think there's a good reason to expect that the uptrend in commodities still has room. No, but I think caution is warranted. No, because about the magnitude of returns moving forward, especially the immediate future. No, looking at the charts of good mining names in the PSE, most of them are still near the bottom of their respective year range. You know, so there's really a lot of upside, even if it would just be a partial retracement of the drop from their peaks. No, but again, we have already seen a good run up recently, and while we know that getting in while the while it's red hot, has its rewards. We have seen this before, and we know that there's also a cost now. So I think just be picky on the names you would be buying into and possibly initiate a position, but keep some dry powder to buy more when a correction happens.
Okay. And Aaron, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, your blind item. Talk to us about this stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. So why do you like this stock?
Okay. So again, this is an index stock. No. So
okay.
Prior to this, I went out of index. Now this is an index stock. Down 18.5% year to date as of yesterday, so pretty battered, no? Deeper loss than the PSEI. It recently reported actually 35% year-on-year increase in revenues in the first quarter, no? Though bulk of the growth came from the project in a quote-unquote friendly country.
Okay.
So FMSEC Research, First Metro Sec Research, is optimistic about this stock. Their target price is actually at 28 pesos per share, which is a good 60% upside from its close yesterday. No, and what's good about it, no, what caught my attention recently was its price movement yesterday. No? It came with a good candle, price action, good bullish price action, and with a good volume.
Okay, I think we've given enough clues to our viewers to guess what this is if they want to take advantage of that massive upside. Aaron, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great week ahead. See you soon.
Thank you, Mimi. See you.
See you. And before we go to a break, we just wanted to share the PSE has started trading. We just heard the opening bell a minute ago, and the index is now down by a third of 1%, 9.6308. That's ahead of the release of first quarter GDP data. We're taking a quick break. Coming up, we're going to be speaking with Stephen Kuonyeng for his forecast ahead of the release of our first quarter GDP numbers. Market Edge, we'll be right back.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks. Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks.
Welcome back. The World Health Organization officially classifies the COVID-19 variant first found in India as a variant of concern. It's the fourth variant to be designated as being of global concern, requiring heightened tracking and analysis since it spreads more easily. The India COVID-19 variant was first identified in October 2020. It has since spread to other countries, and many nations have moved to cut or restrict movements from India.
We're still in a perilous situation. The spread of variants, increased social mixing, the relaxation of public health and social measures, and inequitable vaccination are all driving transmission. Yes, vaccines are reducing severe disease and deaths in countries that are fortunate enough to have them in sufficient quantities. And early results suggest that vaccines might also drive down transmission.
It's not yet clear how much of a factor the India COVID-19 variant has played in the catastrophic surge in cases in the country, but angry calls mount for a nationwide lockdown in India, which is seeing a record number of COVID-19 infections and deaths daily. The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department has also confirmed a Filipino personnel working at the embassy in New Delhi has died of COVID-19. The Philippine government is seeking a $21 million refund from a foreign contractor of the country's Wi-Fi program. The Department of Information and Communications Technology has already written to contractor Speedcast, asking it to turn over the contract and the funds so the agency can implement the program instead. The contractor has been criticized over the slow rollout of the free Wi-Fi program. In 2017, Duterte approved a law that would provide free internet access in public places. But the free Wi-Fi is running at only about 10,000 of some 120,000 target sites.
Ang hinihingi po nating pagbabalik ay ang halagang $21,855,481.63. At kaya po natin hinihingi yung refund na yan dahil hindi naman nila nakabit yung mga Wi-Fi spots na yan. No? E samantalang napatunayan na natin ngayon na kayang-kaya na po yan ang DICT. Sa isang taon, DICT succeeded po na mag-install ng 500% more Wi-Fi hotspots compared dun sa apat na taon na ibinigay dun sa foreign contractor.
Philippine first quarter GDP numbers out in just a few minutes. So far, economists say the Philippines likely remained in recession in the first 3 months of the year amid prolonged lockdowns and rising COVID-19 cases. The estimates vary, some saying the contraction may be somewhere at 3%, while others believe the drop could be as much as 5%. Let's ask our next guest for his take on this. Joining us now, Stephen Ko-Unyeng, senior advisor and former Asia chairman for Evercore. Hi, Stevie. Good morning. Great to have you back.
Thank you for inviting me yet again.
Okay, so Stevie, the consensus is that first quarter will still be a contraction. The second quarter could see low single-digit growth at best. You know, GDP data releases are always after the fact. But looking at today, are you seeing green shoots of recovery?
Well, I don't know. So let's wait for the numbers to come out. But for me, this time in the past, I've said look forward rather than look back. This time, my advice is going to say compare us to our neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Because obviously, everybody's facing challenges and headwinds. So are we doing better or worse? The answer is compared to what? Just like there was this joke, like this bear is rampaging and one camp, there are two campers and one puts on his boots and the other camper says, you can't outrun the bear. And he says, all I need to do is outrun you.
Okay. Right?
So the question is, are we being outrun or are we outrunning? Because it's how are we doing relative to our neighbors? Now, because we're not a very heavy manufacturing driven economy and we're more a service economy, while Thailand would be big service, big manufacturing. Others like Malaysia would be more manufacturing. It's basically going to say, I think services are not recovering as fast as manufacturing is. So therefore, I think my guess, and it's purely a guess, is hopefully there will be improvement compared to last year. But it might not be good relative to our more manufacturing-centric neighbors.
Mm-hmm. Stevie, do you imagine, or how much pressure do you see, are you seeing in keeping MECQ, the second strictest lockdown for the capital and nearby areas, in a bid to protect health at the expense of the economy? How much pressure is there?
I think there's pressure to lift it. Now, I'm not in government. I'm back in Manila, so I'm serving my quarantine. So you're talking to someone who's living the MECQ life right now. And I got, so I'm still in quarantine, but a hotel quarantine. But I think there's pressure, again, because we are very service driven.
Uh-huh.
We really need to open up services sector more because that's what drives the economy. Now, the other part is, in effect, part of what we've done is we've subcontracted, just like if BPO people subcontract their service to us, we've subcontracted our employment growth issue to making people OFWs. So if you look at, frankly, if we're deploying people at a very good pace, I don't recommend that it's the most pleasant way to live, but sometimes it's necessity for a lot of people. But if deployments are moving up, then the GDP figure through the remittances will look good.
And not necessarily a good thing, right?
Yeah, but because then remittances spur spending spurs the business and so on and so forth. But so because we don't have an export-driven manufacturing economy compared to our neighbors, so there is more pressure because if you look at countries like Thailand and Vietnam, they didn't go through an extended GCQ, ECQ. They basically opened up. They just closed borders because what they were exporting were goods, not people. They were importing inputs and not tourists for the time being. So there is pressure because... Mm-hmm. We can't keep this going indefinitely.
Okay. Uh-huh. Stevie, so when the GDP number comes out today, on Thursday, we're not sure if the schedule is going to be moved. It's the turn of the central bank. They're going to have their policy meeting. What are you expecting to hear from the BSP?
Things are fine. Inflation's under control.
Ah, okay. Okay, so you think inflation is under control because there's all of this conversation about rising inflation. I was going to ask you if you think that's driving you or investors to certain assets like commodities, which are booming, or real estate, or perhaps gold.
Okay. Let me give you, again, rather than give you my unlearned opinion, I'd rather use facts and then analyze it. Let's look at gold. Okay. Gold 52-week range is $1,676 to $2,012. Not a very big range, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And what's the price yesterday? $1,836. Actually, less than the midpoint, okay? Because there's a $500 range and it's less than $200 above the low. Now look at copper. The 52-week range is per pound, 240.75 to 488.91. Where is it last night? 487 at the high. Iron ore, the 52-week range is 86.69. And the high is 204.35. Where is it trading now? 204.35 at the high. Now, what is the difference? Gold is an inflation hedge. The other two are industrial commodities. Iron ore gives you steel. Copper is a basic input for manufacturing. So what is the commodity market telling us? Basic metals, base metals, are doing well because they're anticipating economic recovery in manufacturing and demand for goods, basically based on the stimulus spending and pickup in China, the US, and they expect the EU to follow. But do they expect inflation? No, because gold is trading below the 50% two-week range. That's, for me, the objective answer. If people were expecting inflation to go up, they would be buying gold. It's a hedge. Mm-hmm. They're not buying gold, but they're buying copper and they're buying iron ore. That tells me industrialization, manufacturing is going up. Now, one more thing. What about trade? Okay, what, for me, it's not that popular, but one of the most, for me, forward-looking indices is the Baltic Dry Index, right?
Okay.
Because you ship three types of shipping, okay? There's the highest end is tankers. You basically are shipping oil. The lowest are containers. Basically, like balikbayan boxes go into a container, small level of goods go into a container. Bulk carriers carry, like, the whole ship is full of wheat, the whole ship is full of iron ore, the whole ship is copper concentrate. So that's the Baltic Dry Index. Bulk shipping. Bulk is the input that becomes a manufactured good. You ship, like, basically copper goes, copper concentrate goes from Australia, goes to China, then it goes out in containers as manufactured goods, right? So manufactured is a lagging or, I mean, sorry, container prices are a lagging or present indicator. BDI is a forward indicator.
Okay.
Because the higher BDI goes up, the more there is demand for inputs to manufacturing. So what is the BDI range? Wow, what a range to show you the depth of the recession last year to where it is now. The 52-week range is, guess what? The low was last year, $393.
Okay. The
high is $3,266. Wow. And what is it yesterday? $3,183. Within 5% of its high, which is 1,000% above its low. Now, that's telling you what's happening with manufacturing.
Okay.
People are importing the basic inputs, iron ore, copper, wheat, soybeans. That's what goes into bulk carriers. That's what's captured by the BDI, the Baltic Dry Index.
Okay.
You're seeing gold going up. So you're not, so whatever, rightly or wrongly, they're not worried about inflation yet. But they are anticipating robust manufacturing demand because iron ore is at its high. Copper is at its high. Transporting that is at its very high.
Okay. Stevie,
1,000% above the low last year.
That bodes well for many of the economies who are dependent on it. Stevie, we don't have much time. I wanted to ask, to end this conversation with a final question on this. More political relationships. Let's talk about the ties that bind. It's very obvious, you know, the global interconnectedness was highlighted by this pandemic. You know, economies depend on each other to remain open, for supplies, for demand, to vaccinate populations, to really just support each other. What are some of the key things, perhaps language you'll be looking for, to give us a clearer picture of how relationships are resetting? Maybe Philippine relationship with the U.S., Philippine relationship with China, just very quickly.
Okay, very simply, there's vaccine hoarding and vaccine democracy. Now, people say, why did the US and the UK and some other countries order not just more vaccines than they have, 3, 4, 5 times the vaccines they needed. I will put things in context. One is, they in effect underwrote the cost of developing vaccines. That's why you got it done in less than a year. Number two, let's not forget where things were when they made these investments early in 2020, during the hype. You didn't know who was going to succeed or not.
Yeah.
Did you expect Moderna to succeed, but yet Sanofi, Merck, Bristol, you know, didn't succeed? So they had to make multiple bets because they were all betting who would actually come up with a vaccine that works. So that's why they had to overorder, because they didn't know who was going to win or not. Now, obviously, we know who won. Like, Merck gave up. Sanofi gave up. They said, we're just going to subcontract and build for others. Now, they're still going to try the next wave or other related. But basically, for this wave, you're kind of seeing who it's going to be. It's going
okay.
to be Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson in the U.S., AstraZeneca in Europe, plus, you know, the Russians and the Chinese and the Indians. So now what you're seeing is, as the vaccination rates go down, you're now in the U.S. When I went to the U.S. in March, I basically was scrambling every day to get the slot, and I was able to get the slot the day after I arrived. But trust me, I was really feverishly looking, and I double vaccinated with Moderna. So, you know, if you want to invite me in live next time, I'm fully vaccinated. Right? But my point is, so now you're looking at the U.S. saying, the old Ingeborg Humperdinck song, please release me, because they will release the vaccines because they don't need it anymore as production is ramping up. It's more than the supply you need. At the same time, you're going to see China and India, who are huge manufacturing areas for vaccines, saying, now we actually need it for us. So I think you're going to see some kind of balance shifting. In the early stage, like the Serum Institute of India, the first few months, actually exported 60 million vaccines to 70 countries. And then when they said, now we need it for ourselves because of what's going on, they've said, for the next 3 months, don't expect exports for us. We got over 1 billion people. We need that supply. 60 million a month, that's nothing for 1 billion people. So they're going to wrap it up. Other people will do it. So you might see basically the people like China, who handled the pandemics side very well, were less obsessed about vaccinating quickly. The people who handled the pandemic side relatively poorly, the US and the UK, basically says, let's wrap the vaccine rollout like crazy and take advantage of our orders. Now, basically close to half, more than half of adults in the U.S. have had at least one dose. And now, from a high of 3.3 million a day and weekends over 4 million, they're down to about 2 million people getting vaccinated. Because over half have been vaccinated. So I think you're going to see a shift.
Okay. Exciting times ahead. And we are going to be watching as things unfold. Stevie, it's, you know, time is never enough with you on the show. We got to get you back again soon. Thank you so much for joining us and for the insights, as always.
Thank you again for inviting me.
Okay, and before we go, for those who tried to guess our blind item for today, the stock pick of Aaron Tsai, this index stock was down 19% year to date as of yesterday. It recently reported a 35% year-on-year increase in revenues in the first quarter. The bulk of the growth came from the project in quote-unquote friendly country. The target price from First Metro Securities Researchers optimistic at 28 pesos. That is a good 60% upside from its close yesterday. This stock is Robinson Land Corporation, the property arm of the Gokongwei Group. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. And thank you so much for watching us. That is it for our show. I'm Michelle Long. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available on Spotify. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.